Namaskar and very good morning. I take this privilege to welcome the delegates on the second session of the day, the technological perspective and state of nation with specific reference to technology. I do, however, request Sri Haunurji, the president of the function, and Dr. Sateesh Reddy, the keys. This very session will be focused on the technological perspective and the state of the nation with specific reference to technological development of India. And we have Dr. Sateesh Reddy to share his ideas and knowledge about the subject. I'm honored to introduce Dr. Sateesh Reddy, such an eminent personality in India. Dr. Sateesh Reddy is an Indian aerospace scientist and presently a scientific advisor to the Raksha Mantri and Director General, Missiles and Strategic Systems. Earlier, he has served as the director of the research center in Imarat, a key lab of Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam Missile Complex, DRDO, Advanced Center for Design, Development and Delivery of Avionics Systems for Missiles and Other Applications. Dr. Reddy has pioneered in many technological developments for Indian missiles and has made significant contributions towards successful flight testings of the country's maiden intercontinental ballistic missiles, ICBM, Agni 5 mission. In June 2015, he was appointed as the scientific advisor to the Defense Minister of India. Dr. Reddy has led the RCI lab as a program director, successfully spearheaded the development of medium-range surface-to-air missiles, it is MRSAM program, which scored a perfect hat-trick in its first three consecutive missions. Honorable President and Honorable Defense Minister of India has extended their best wishes for MRSAM team. Dr. Reddy has been decorated with a lot of recognitions and awards. Dr. Reddy is a fellow of the Royal Institute of Navigation in London, the first from India. He's a fellow of the Royal Aeronautical Society, a foreign member of the Indian Academy of the Navigation and Motion Control, Russia. He has received the Homi J. Bhabha Memorial Award of the Indian Science Congress Association in the year 2013-14. Dr. Reddy has been selected for the Institute of Engineers India, Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers, that is IEEE Award for Engineering Excellence 2015. The joint award establishment by the IEI India and the IEEE USA. In 2015, he has received honorary doctorates in science from Amity University, Noida, Geetam University, Hyderabad, KL University, Guntur, and JNTU, Kakinada. Dr. Reddy was chosen the first institution of engineers, Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineer, United States. He was awarded for engineering of excellence. Sateesh Reddy is chairman of Aeronautical Society in Hyderabad and has initiated the international collaboration for promotion of aerospace sector in India. And the list continues to go on. With this, I request Dr. Sateesh Reddy, sir, to please share your ideas, sir. May I welcome, sir.
Very good morning. Organizers of the Prabuddha Bharat, Manyavar Nagaraji, Shankaranandji, the professors, academicians, the Commissioner of Police, Sri Bhatji, many industrialists who are present here, the elite of Belgaum area or Belgavi area, and then the most important people of the today's scenario, the students who are present here from various academic institutes. Once again, very good morning to all of you. In fact, yesterday I was a little unhappy, rather disturbed, because too many activities were there and I was literally struggling for the time. And then coming to Belgaum and almost for that sake spending about complete 2 days was a little disturbing me. See, so much of activities are there and then I'm losing 2 days and all that. But having entered Belgaum, then yesterday evening I had gone to a couple of industries here, then met a couple of people yesterday, today morning, a lot of people. It's an eye-opener here coming to Belgaum. Had I not come to Belgaum, probably I would have missed something till my next coming here. A lot of young entrepreneurs, a lot of people who have gone to US, who have come back, who have established industries here. And people whom I have met here also today, whenever I met almost all, I felt I am meeting a specific person, whether it's look of him, dress of him, the way he talks, and what is the background. It really impressed. I'm not trying to say just because I've come to Belgaum here and so I have to talk to you, so I have to impress you people and all that. I'm not saying so. I'm really saying I came to a city or town which is really an elite town or elite district in the country. That's what the feeling with which I will be going back from here. Thank you very much for inviting me here. And definitely the need of the day is such districts in the country. And I think it is one district which is really Honorable Prime Minister's idea of Make in India, which you people are making it a reality here in this district. So that is the need of the hour for the entire country to have more and more districts like this. And I wish you all prosper and you all come up with many more industries, and we also will try to support you the way what we can support the best. Thank you very much once again. Then coming to the presentation of mine today, it is organized like this. One thing is the organizers or the idea of the Prabuddha Bharat talk about the technologies, what the country has developed and where we stand today, because state of the nation, that's the theme. So talk about the state of the technologies. But then, a little bit in the beginning, what India has contributed previously, and then where we stand in technologies. But then, when you come out the technologies where we stand today, the technologies domain is very, very, very wide open. A lot of areas are there. It's very difficult to cover all of them in an hour's talk or so. What I thought is, covered the space research, space technologies, covered a little bit about atomic energy, and then me coming from Ministry of Defense, so covered a lot about defense technologies, where we stand, what it is, and how it goes and all that, so that you have more and more, and you also have a lot of military presence here, and then you also have a military procurement system being established here in Belgaum, so that will also be helping you. But then, before starting my talk, one thing I want to say, there have been many eras wherein many countries have become prosperous out of many things. Some countries in the past, let's say 500 years, 1,000 years back, prospered of the natural resources what they had. Some out of some sorts of a business. Somebody out of agriculture, like that. But today, it is technology which is making the nations, many nations, strength. The strength of the economic strength of many nations is out of technologies. For example, when you take Finland, after the Russian Empire has collapsed, the adjacent country, Finland, the economy of the country also has fallen below line. So the chief of the nation, looking at various options, has called for ideas how we can build the nation back, what it should be and all that. Youngsters, very young people, have come out with the idea of the cellular phone, and idea is accepted. Nokia has come, ruled the world for almost about 15 years, definitely 10 to 15 years, and the nation has prospered out of it for a long time till later, last 3-4 years, a lot of business competitions and all that. There are later stages. You, in the technology field, somebody cannot remain static. Today's technologies are changing so fast, if you remain static on one technology, it may not last for more than 15 to 20 years. So that's a different story. What I'm trying to say is technology is playing a very important role today, and that is what is the need of the hour. And that's why Honorable Prime Minister has brought in the Make in India concept and also the Startup India concept. So this just wanted to say before starting of my talk. Next slide, please. So what India has done, India has done to the world, has given to the world, these are all the things what I just wanted to say. A couple of minutes I'll spend on this and see that look at the type of contributions what our people have done in various areas, whether it is mathematics or trigonometry. Morning, first talk was, he has dealt a lot on the trigonometry, or the decimal systems, whether it is zero or infinity or the largest number, many things, whatever you say. Then to the algebra, the quadratic equations, and many things. There are details are also given here. I am not getting into the details. Somebody wants to see it, they can see, or later they can take the presentation and look at it, what many people have contributed in many areas. And even geometry. A tremendous contributions which people have, in fact, I had many quotes also to be brought in here, and people, famous scientists, what they have said that if India was not there, definitely we would not have been in this state. That is what many famous scientists said for the type of contributions what we have done into the various areas of science and technology. Getting into the science and technology, right from paramanu, atoms, or nuclear related activities, or the astronomy, whether Aryabhata or many people who have done, people who have found out the radius of Earth those days, what is the dimensions of Earth those days, have found out many things. Many things connected to this have been found out in those areas. Let me tell you a subject which is directly connected to me. I am actually, even though I am a missile scientist, the core area of mine in the missiles is navigation. I have been a navigation scientist for almost about 25 years working in the navigation area. And till about 90s, probably we didn't have a navigation system of our own completely developed in the country indigenously. But then when you look at the history back, the navigation origin was in India. Started in the Sindhu River, when our people were going in the Sindhu River in small boats and things like that, and when they were traveling, when they were coming back, they found a new method of traveling in that river in the boats. Through the reflection of the sun rays on the stones and the water in the river, and now they have named it as Navgati. The Navgati has gone out, it has become in Latin as Navgati, Navgat, and then it became navigation. And then later we have learned this subject from them as navigation to India, and now we have become self-reliant in this area by year 2000. What we have done 2,000, 3,000 years back, what we have given to the world, we have come back and again learned. So there are so many technologies what the country has developed, our ancient people have developed, and then we are able to see here. Then medicine, whether it is Charaka or Shushruta, particularly the type of surgeries what Shushruta has done, the type of instruments what he has used, the type of natural instruments what he has used for many things, which are antiseptic. I was talking to a neurosurgeon other day, who is a professor in neurosurgeon. He was trying to say the bears and other animals, thorns have been used for stitching, and the hair of that has been used for the stitching of the skins in the surgeries, which automatically acted as antiseptic and things like that. And that's many things what those days they have used instruments and things like that in those days, Charaka and the type of Ayurveda what people have generated, and people are trying to now learn out of it, read those books, what they have done that time. Then education. We all know what was there in Takshashila, and then what was there in Nalanda. More than 10,000 students from all over the world were coming and trying to learn between these two universities, 60 to about 120 subjects, with about 1,500 teachers, gurus were there who were teaching various subjects in those both universities what were there, both in Takshashila and Nalanda. This is what is the heritage what we had in every aspect of it. I have only covered just technology, science, education, mathematics. These are the only areas which I have touched upon related to my topic today. This is what we have given it to the world, and this is what is the heritage what we had. If you look at why we have to tell about this background, it is many people we will be seeing here who were their grandfathers were jamindars, and now that fellow will not be doing anything, roaming around the roads and not doing anything, saying that my grandfather was a jamindar and all that. It is not that. The situation has become in the country in such a way that the influence of the advanced nations or the Western countries has become in the country so much that we do not know anything. We are not innovative people. We do not have that type of a brains what you can discover science, technologies, or innovations and all that. We always have been inheriting from them. This is what, has been created. People, if somebody goes into the depth of it, like what the Chinese traveler here, he has talked about Nalanda here. Or one more incident, probably like to mention, when the gramophone record was invented, Edison, he thought, what is the first voice he should record? Then he went to Max Muller. Then Max Muller said, there is a conference in London. There are many world-renowned people will be coming. You come there and we will record it. So he went there in the morning session. Then he called Max Muller. He said something. Then Edison went back, did it in all the lab, and came back in the afternoon, and he played it. People heard the voice of Max Muller. Some machine say, why Max Muller voice is coming out from a machine. People are well thrilled, a lot of claps were there, the hall was full of sounds and all that. Then Max Muller, at the end of all that silence, he asked, what did I say? Nobody knew anything. Did you understand? He replayed again. He said, what language it is? He said, it is in the Indian Vedas, first shloka. What I have put it here in the gramophone record, that is what you all people have listened. So that is what the first recording what has gone into the gramophone record. That is what people had great thing to India as a respect. People who have learnt it. But we are not learning, so we are not got into it. So we have to tell the people that we had a heritage like this. You have brains which are so powerful brains with you, please utilize them and make the nation powerful. That is why the background is required. Otherwise, we don't have to live in the background. We don't have to live ages back and then keep telling about it. It is just to give the confidence with the people that you are having the brains what you can make. You can become really the guru of the world. So you please work towards that direction and have confidence, have self-confidence and come out of it is the only idea why we say this is our heritage. Now, when you look at the three technologies, what I have said, space, we have definitely done a lot of wonders in space. What Dr. Kalam, when he was there as a project director, going from SLV, then ASLV, then the PSLV, Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle, then GSLV, Geostationary Launch Vehicle. In fact, the polar satellite launch vehicle, which puts it in the polar orbit of any satellites, it has become one of the wonders of the world. Why I'm telling you is, ISRO with the last launch, they had 35th successful testing of the PSLV. Successful testing of, that means in a row continuously you had 35 successful launches. This is what ISRO has done wonders. put many satellites, one satellite, two satellites in one fellow, 17 satellites in the orbit. Many things they have done. Then coming to GSLV, we were dependent on some of the technologies, like cryogenics. We were not having, we had to get from outside. Then people were, as usual, trying to threaten you, we will not give you, we will give you, we will use it, don't use it, sort of a things. So finally, our own scientists, we have developed ourselves the cryogenic engine, and that's how, with indigenous cryogenic engines, the GSLV is flying today, launching many satellites in the geostationary orbit at 36,000 kilometers altitude, many of our satellites today. That is what, again, our people have achieved. Now, you are able to put about 2,000 kg satellite approximately in the orbit today. The next mission, GSLV-3, is going to put 4,000 kg satellites in the orbit. That is next definition. Then, another important development is, you all know what is GPS, Global Positioning System. Everybody you see in your mobile, you get your position. So only US was having that GPS system. And generally, particularly in a war scenario, they stop those signals and you won't be able to use it military purpose. So Russia has developed its own system called GLONASS. Then looking at it, Europe also wanted to develop their own system, Galileo, but then various problems, you know, that European nation always has got a problem, so they're not able to progress well. But Chinese have come forward. They have developed their own system called COMPASS. It's near completion of the constellation. Then India took up the program called IRNSS. We are only contained to our region, India plus about 2,000 kilometers borders or 2,500 kilometers borders. Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System, IRNSS. Now, the seven satellites are in orbit today, and anybody has got a receiver, you also can get an IRNSS position equivalent to GPS. Everything works well, and we don't have to be worried about in the war scenario or other scenarios, it will be stopped or it will be denied or it will be spoofed or whatnot and all that. You have your own complete system. You have become the fourth nation having such capabilities in the world to have your own navigation system. In fact, even with PSLV and GSLV also, you have become one of the four and five nations who have such capabilities today in the space. Then, you have GSAT series, INSAT series, and all that. I don't want to get into it a lot. Then you have done the Mars mission. Fantastic mission, what it has gone all the way to Mars. And definitely, Belgavi has contributed in this, into the couple of industries. So Belgae also contributed into the Mars mission today. Then you had Chandrayaan mission. There also, many industries have contributed a lot. And we have done the Chandrayaan mission. And you know the stories, what we have also given to US and all that from Chandrayaan mission, what we have done, hyperspectral imaging and many things what we have done. So these are all what happening there. And finally, we are also trying to enter back into the atmosphere. You are trying to get the re-entry vehicle. The experiment has been done with the parachute. It has been recovered. Parachute is given by a DRDO laboratory in Agra. And those experiments are also going on very, very successfully. Soon we'll also have a going and coming back into the space, and all those experiments will be done soon. Then also, as I said, some more experimental aspects have been done. You must have heard very recently, there has been a scramjet engine which has been tested by ISRO, which is a very important engine for a hypersonic vehicle, and also for a space vehicle to be used as an intermediate stage. This experiment has been done for about 5 seconds, which is again a very successful experiment which is done very recently. So lot of experiments ISRO has placed us anything between in various experiments 2 to 5. In the world, we are in one experiment, we are the second nation. In one experiment, we are the fourth nation. In one experiment, we are the fifth nation. So ISRO has placed us, anybody who puts a space map, space assets map, India is one among the five nations who have in the world. That is what ISRO has done to this country. Now coming to atomic energy, we again, with the limited capabilities and limited resources what we have in the country, we have also established many plants in the country today. Nuclear reactors, and we are able to generate power close to about 6,000 megawatts we are able to generate now. Probably about 2030-32, it may go to more than 50,000 megawatts also. Let me tell you one thing. Generally in this country, whenever we talk about nuclear power, a lot of apprehensions are there in the minds of the people. One thing, we should wipe out these apprehensions. If we need to have a good industrial growth in the country, uninterrupted, free and full power supply, electricity is a necessity to the country. We just cannot be developing our own electricity only through coal or hydel and other things. It is just not possible. Look at the world. Many countries have developed their power out of the nuclear power. And I want to tell you, nuclear accidents have not killed anyone till now. Let me tell you, nuclear reactors, whether what has happened in Japan or even what has happened in Russia, Chernobyl. Chernobyl, one boy has died. That is because he sneaked into area after the accident has happened when people were not allowed to into that area. This is what. Whereas, you look at the road accidents what happen in India every day. I don't think it is less than 200 people a day. Whereas in entire nuclear history, I don't think anybody has died out of a nuclear power reactor's accident today. So we should not unnecessarily stop many things which are coming, what people are thinking in the government, and try to say that we don't want nuclear power and all that. What we need is electricity today, otherwise the industries won't be able to survive, industry won't be able to establish in the country. So we have many reactors have been developed out of plutonium, uranium, and many thorium and all that. And then many raw materials, particularly like this, have been developed in the country. Like RIFM steel is an important steel what has been developed in the country by Medhani and has been given into the ITER activity here, and which has been used here. It is a very, very successful material what the country has developed and given it to them. So a lot more is happening in this area, and then we have to see the anchor. These activities are anchorage, and then we get a lot from this nuclear to the society, to the civilian sector, a lot from this sector, and people are doing wonders in this area. Now, when I enter into the defense, there are many areas of defense. As I said, I will be concentrating only on the three areas, space, nuclear, and then on defense, particularly in the defense technologies a lot. We have missiles, we have aeronautics, we have armament, vehicles, and communications, electronic systems, naval systems, and many things. I'll be covering one by one in each area. Let's see. Coming to the first, in a civilian sector, we also have developed some aircrafts in the country. Like the one which is there here, Saras, is a good aircraft which NIL has developed. Of course, this slide is not much connected to the defense. It is only talking about the aeronautics sector, so having talked about it, I'm only giving this slide. But the aircrafts are used for some of the defense purposes also. The Saras, of course, is program is capped because there was an accident and all that. And then some of these, again, aircrafts also have been developed by NIL, which people are still going ahead and trying to work on this. But then all these aircrafts have been good aircrafts. What made them is not doing well is out of the commercials. You need to be very good in the commercial aspects also. Anybody who develops a technology here also, you need to be very good in your commercial aspects. You should be able to do a good business. Then only you will be able to survive and you will be able to do, which I think we are not at good in those aspects and trying to see. But then Saras, out of an accident only, the problem had come. Then coming to the area of fighter aircrafts, the most important thing is LCA, the light combat aircraft, the Tejas aircraft, which now India is producing, Bangalore is producing in numbers. Then we also have LCA Navy aircraft, which on the naval platform, it will be able to take off and then use it. Then we have a LCA trainer, which is built again. Then we also have a HTT, Hindustan, a HL Turbo Trainer 40, is an aircraft which again HL has made and undergoing trials. Little bit I need to tell here, because again there are a lot of misgivings here among the people about LCA. Because everywhere we see, LCA has taken 25 years, what the country has been doing, why you have been doing, how much money you have spent. I will give you my own example. When we started the missile program in the country with Dr. Kalam as the director of Defense Research and Development Laboratory in Hyderabad, probably we didn't have more than about 10 industries working there who can do some supplies for us. Almost you started making nut and bolt also yourself and started making this, and you have come up to this stage. Today, if you look at it, I have about more than 500 industries, which are working for missiles today. But then, same thing for the LCA also. They also didn't have anything. Look at the aircraft, Rafale, which we have signed just day before yesterday, European nations. Tremendous amount of industries. The ecosystem was fantastic in that country. The aircraft has taken from 16 to 18 years with that type of ecosystem, with that type of technology available in those nations. If they have taken 16 to 18 years without anything, without any aeronautical engineer here, that time there was no aeronautics department at all except in IIT Kharagpur, there was no aeronautical engineer being produced in the country. 25 years, is it a crime? For a country like us, 25 years, you have developed one of the aircrafts which only six nations in the world have developed today. Only six nations. That is the type of aircraft, and the present air chief, he also had an apprehension. We requested him, you please fly this aircraft and then talk about it. He himself has flown and said this is one of the fantastic aircrafts what the country has built, and immediately gave 108 aircrafts order, which is the single largest order from Air Force which is given to HAL today for 108 aircrafts. So this is the situation. When we have shown other day in Arabs, in the air show there, Bahrain, lot of interest from various people for this aircraft. Today, the situation is now we have to see that HAL produces these numbers in time with the quality. That is the type of, we keep in criticizing our own systems and we keep on thinking about it. If somebody is trying to establish an aero system here, they were having 4,000 scientists, 4,000 engineers to work on this. Whereas ADA has about 500 engineers working on it. So the country doesn't have resources. Country doesn't have institutes today. How many aeronautics? Day before yesterday, I was giving a talk in JNU. One professor got up and asked me, do you have an aeronautics university in the country? And how many universities are there in China or other countries? Today, we don't have a university here. We have aeronautics as a subject in some of the colleges. So without getting many engineers and all that, and without that, how do we go about it? So this is the type of a scenario what we have in the country, and now we are in a better shape. We definitely don't need, if you need another aircraft, definitely we also will be able to do in about 10 to 12 years today, which is a normal type for anything. Then coming to helicopters, we also have built many of the helicopters today. ALH, Advanced Light Helicopter, which is flying today. Then we have light combat aircraft, which can be equipped with many of the arms, many of the missiles, that's also flying. So you have many, and light utility helicopter, other day only it has taken off and it has done its maiden first flight. HL Bangalore is producing many of these helicopters very successfully, both for Army and Air Force. These helicopters are being delivered, which are completely indigenous helicopters which are being produced in the country today. Then coming to the UAVs, unmanned aerial vehicles. Of course, many private industries are producing. Close to you here in Pune, there are a couple of industries who are producing small UAVs and all that. But then the larger UAVs, like which are called MALES, medium altitude long endurance vehicles, meaning you fly at about 25,000-30,000 altitude, and you have 28-29 hours of flying. So you have Rustum 2, which shortly will be taking off from here, close to in Karnataka itself, the experiments will be done, which will have about 26 to 29 hours of endurance, It can go to about 1,000 kilometers and also can be equipped with many of the things, many of the payloads and all that. One of the best UAVs in the world the country will be having by 2017. So these are various other aspects you can see here. There are very small mini and micro UAVs, which are 2 kgs, 300 grams UAVs, which have been developed, which have been put into use by various DRDO laboratories, which are there in Bangalore called Aeronautical Development Establishment, ADE, which is doing all this UAV work with many of the payloads, many of the varieties of UAVs which country is having. Even though we have imported some UAVs, definitely we are going to have all these UAVs by about next year or next to next year. Then coming to the radars, about 10 years back, we were, I think, having only one or two radars. Now today I can say, any radar what the armed forces want, definitely all those radars can be built in the country and then supplied to the armed forces today. Look at varieties of radars what have been made here in the country, which are being given to the armed forces, all this. Particularly, look at this radar, which I'll be talking about it, the Rajendra radar, which is used for the most powerful surface-to-air missile, what we have developed for Akash, is the very accurate radar what has been developed. The radar is able to guide the missile, go close to the aircraft and hit the aircraft or close proximity and damage the aircraft. This is one which is used in Akash today. Then also we are able to build today the long-range radars and multifunction fire control radars are also we are able to build in the country today. These, again, as I said, about 15 years back, we have imported the radars. Now we are able to build. This is again a lab in Bangalore called LRDE, Electronics Research and Development Establishment Laboratory in Bangalore, which is doing all this radars work. I can say we are self-reliant in the area of radars completely today. Next, coming to the naval systems, we have a naval design bureau, and we also have in laboratories in the naval area, which are doing again a lot of work, and we could design many of the vessels today in the country, more than about 100 vessels which have gone into the Navy, designed by these people and built by our shipyards which are there all across the East Coast and West Coast. They could develop it. And then most important being the nuclear-powered indigenous submarine Arihant is built by the country, which has given it to the armed forces. And the most important being air independent propulsion is also being made in the adjacent state from here, which makes a submarine doesn't have to surface for about 14 days. Today, probably every 14 hours or every 18 hours, you have to surface. This system will be making the submarines, you don't have to surface for about 14 days. So this is another important development in the country the technologies have taken place. Then coming to the torpedoes, very recently, you must have seen Honorable Raksha Mantri has handed over this to the Indian Navy, the Varunastra torpedo, which has about 40 kilometers range. A torpedo is used against the ship or a submarine, indigenous torpedo. A lot of export potential, a lot of countries are showing interest in this torpedo, which we will be exporting a lot. Then this is advanced lightweight torpedo. Then you also have sonar systems, meaning if a torpedo is fired against you, how do you divert it? Is a sonar, what you use it, that is called MARICH, anti-torpedo defense system, has been made by a laboratory in Cochin. And then there are a number of mines and other things, underwater mines also have been developed by these laboratories. And torpedoes and anti-torpedo systems, again, you have become today self-reliant in the country with the many technologies what have been developed by these laboratories, both in Vishakhapatnam and also in Cochin. Then coming to the area of missiles, a little bit personally where I am connected, so allow me, I will spend a little more time here in this missiles area being my subject. Now, 1982, Dr. Kalam has come and has taken over as director of this missile laboratory in Hyderabad. We didn't have a single missile of our own that day. And we were only doing a lot of experiments, and good scientists were there who were working on it. So in the year 1982 plus, Dr. Kalam has gone to Government of India with a lot of confidence, and I will say that he had the courage and guts to ask the Government of India, when you didn't have a single successful missile, He went with a 5-missile program to the government, and he could convince them, and he brought a program with 5 missiles called Integrated Guided Missile Development Program, with the 5 missiles being Prithvi, Agni, Akash, Trishul, Nag. At a time, 5 missiles he brought in as one program, saying that I will simultaneously work on 5 missiles. And the first missile, Prithvi, when we want to test also, we didn't have a range. We had to go to Sriharikota, the space launch center. And the first missile, Prithvi, in the year 1988 was tested from Sriharikota. In fact, I was also an youngster who was lucky enough to participate in all these activities at the time. And when we took the missile and kept on the launch pad for a launch, the scientists there, what they said is, we had about 80% success. Meaning making a missile and trying to launch and keeping on the launch pad, getting ready for a launch itself is a greatness, and you have already succeeded 80%. That is what we were thinking those days. Luckily, and whatever the amount of concentration, the first missile was very successful. And that Prithvi has become 150 kilometers, 350 kilometers, and number of missiles have been produced, have been handed over to armed forces in large numbers, and then they have been using this for various training and other things. So this is about Prithvi, which the same one has been converted into Dhanush as a ship-launched version, and the same thing has been handed over to the services as a ship-launched missile from a ship-to-ship application, other applications, which has been again successfully handed over to the armed force. Now look at the Agni missile. After the year 1988, when we have flight tested the first Agni, first Prithvi, in the year 1989, Agni was test fired from the range at Balasur. I was telling you that when Prithvi was launched, you didn't have a range. So as Dr. Kalam, he took these 5 missiles simultaneously development, he took some more activities simultaneously, range for the defense building at Balasur district in Orissa. That is one activity which he has taken. Simultaneously, he wanted to have a laboratory which is of international standard. So RCI, Research Center Imarat in Hyderabad, was built in an international standard in a campus of about 2,300 acres. So many activities simultaneously. 1988, we launched Prithvi. 1988, we inaugurated RCI. President has come and inaugurated RCI. See, a new lab is getting entered and everybody is shifting. Then the same year ending, the range is ready. And within few months, we went with the Agni launch as an experimental model. 1989 May, the first Agni was launched, which world was watching, and then you had a very successful launch in the very first mission itself. Agni was successful, showing the re-entry parameters. Why I'm saying the experimental one is, when you look at this top nose tip portion of this Agni, it goes out of atmosphere and enters back into the atmosphere. Each variety of missile travels with anything between 1500 meters per second to about 7 kilometers per second velocity. When you enter with that type of a speed back into the atmospheric friction retards this vehicle, that means decelerates this vehicle, to any amount between 20 G to about 95 G. 95 G, that means 950 meters per second square is the deceleration what you have. This type of a deceleration generates tremendous amount of heat on this body. So which the temperature can be, again, as I said, anything between 1,000 to about 2,700 degrees temperature on the surface of it. But then there are lots of electronics inside which will be operating at about 50 degrees temperature. You need to have a material which can withstand and which will be bearing this temperature and doesn't allow the temperature to go inside. That was the experiment through Agni, what has been done in the year 1989, and this technology through industries have been established, and that is the technology which has resulted today. Agni 1, Agni 2, Agni 3, Agni 4, Agni 5, various ranges, 700, 2000, 3000, 4000 and 5000 kilometers range missiles, particularly Agni 5 being the longest range for India, which also gets into the bracket of intercontinental ballistic missiles range, Agni 5. And which was again a very successful mission, which has video here, Agni 5. This is Agni 5 launch, which was again shown in the TVs and you all would have seen. So this defense is a three-stage stage one, stage two, stage three.
Solar satellite in,
it has gone into the Australian waters. 5,000 kilometers is the travel. Many technologies have been put into it first time. In fact, a conical rotor motor has been made in this, which is a motor. There have been composite rocket motors, meaning the casing of the motor is the composite materials. And so many things have been...
The atmospheric interceptor performs the same at altitudes below 25 kilometers. The second demonstration of interception took place against actual target missile.
I like to mention here two things.
It was held on 6th December 2007 from the Island Launch Complex, Orissa. The target missile, simulating the 600 kilometers class of ballistic missile, was prepared and launched by army personnel from the Launch Complex 3 at Chandipur. Soon after the launch, the radars located at Konark and Paradeep detected the missile and
what I want to say is,
to the mission control center,
so many technologies which have gone into
secured communication network.
It was in fact very impressive to
after
all of us also who are working that all the technologies
missile,
which have been put into it first time itself, they worked so perfectly.
Kilometers.
It was really wondering to us.
The mission
second,
control center assigned
when
the task
it has traveled more than 5,000 kilometers, the type of accuracy what we have achieved
complex
is phenomenal.
Approximately 4 minutes,
it was in just two digits number over 5,000 kilometers what we could achieve. That is what the navigation systems and guidance systems accuracy.
In fact,
I was thinking that I was sitting there along with the police commissioner there, somebody else was sitting in front of me, and then he was telling someone about strength and weaknesses. I just want to mention the same statements what he has done. I don't remember, I'm not able to see
the interceptor missile.
Before these Agni launches, and particularly Agni 5 launch,
homed on to the target,
people were talking that India will not be able to do. They were not trying to give us critical elements, critical sensors, critical materials, and trying to stop us, how they will see and all
with
that.
The relative velocity,
they were
2.5
looking at us sarcastically that you will not be able to do. But
the
when you have proven this, and people also know that what type of accuracy it has gone.
During the very
Cheney
first
said,
trial,
first, it is not just 5,000 kilometers, but has got more than 7,000 kilometers range
missile,
is what
as
we
seen
know.
By
this is what Cheney says.
And on the radars,
then Americans say,
along with
the same people who are not giving us
have once
the statement comes from them,
the
we know that Indians have this capability, and they can do also. And also we are sure that They don't use it unnecessarily, and they will use it only for peaceful purposes. This is the type of a statement which has come from US.
Defense Research Development Organization,
meaning,
DRDO,
when you are weak, whatever statement you are telling, I
India's
want to repeat the same statement. When
it
you are weak, people look at you sarcastically. When you become stronger, the same person appreciates you. So what is important is nation becoming stronger by technologies is the most important thing what we need. Then we also have developed many of the underwater missiles. We are very strong in that area. Then coming to other missiles, this is one very important missile which has been developed indigenously, Akash, a surface-to-air missile, a much better missile than a Patriot missile. And with the radar, what I have said, it has been very successful, and services have been very happy. Both Army, Air Force have placed a number of orders. Today, the Bharat Dynamics Limited has got about 22,000 crores orders for Akash. 22,000 crores for orders. Second, in the Akash, when you look at it, 83% of the items are coming from private industry to BDL. BDL has become a lead integrator today. So many industries have flourished supplying to Akash. Imagine in a missile system today, Bharat Dynamics Limited is getting 83% from private industry. Is a fantastic thing. That's how the industries are flourishing. This is what, give a hand to the industries, give them the help, and give them sufficient orders which can be sustained for some years, industry will be able to do wonders. That is what it shows that Akash has come up. Then you also have, Astra missile. This is another very important missile, air-to-air missile, which has been indigenously developed, which has got about anything from 40 to 100 kilometers range, air-to-air missile, a pretty accurate missile, what has been developed, and it is being inducted to the Air Force. Then we also have a helicopter-launched anti-tank missile, which is used against that, used along the ALH. Then we have a Nag missile, which is again a fire and forget missile using a imagery, infrared image as the technology, which I'll be talking about a little later, which is again a very important missile which has been developed in the country, and soon it will be done. Then coming to the cruise missiles, which are very important missiles, which fly at a low altitude so that the enemy radars cannot see those missiles. We have developed two missiles. One is Nirbhay. This is can travel about 1,000 kilometers at a low altitude. Then this is a subsonic cruise missile, meaning the speed of that missile is less than the sound speed, which is about 300 to 330 meters per second or so, and less than that, the missiles travels. Coming to the BrahMos, a little bit again I have to tell you. BrahMos is a very special missile. I think morning Parag was mentioning about that BrahMos missile, the speciality and all that. This is an Indo-Russian joint venture. The name itself has come as from the two rivers which are there, Brahmaputra and Moskva River, which are there in Russia, and Brahmaputra here combined the name, trying to get similarity to Brahmastra, so it is called BrahMos, a missile which has been developed as a company name and a missile name which has done. The Kalam had, whenever we launched right from Prithvi to Agni-1, Agni-2 and many missiles, what was happening is you were becoming one of the five or six or seven nations who have that capability. So whenever any times, you must have read in the papers also, India has become one of the six nations who have this capability of Agni-2 missile. And or otherwise, when you launch Agni-1 missile, you are become one of the seven nations who have such capabilities. Every time you used to say that whenever you had a success meeting, hey funny guys, when you are going to come out of this six or seven syndrome, when you are going to give me the first of its kind missile in the world? This is what the question he always used to ask. To make his dream a reality, he himself was there, and this Indo-Russian joint venture has been proposed. The complete airframe and engine is from Russia. The complete avionics is from India. These two have been combined, and you have done a very successful missile. Today, even today, that is the only supersonic cruise missile available with any armed forces in the world today. India is the only country which has this supersonic cruise missile in the world today. That is the greatness of this BrahMos missile. You can see the video here, BrahMos missile, very interesting videos, you can see that. Launched from a ship.
1, 2, 3, 4, last 5 seconds. Vehicle normal.
Executing very high
G maneuvers and
sharp turns, the interceptor missile, guided by the radio frequency seeker, homed on the target.
Surface launch, land launch, and land target.
Interceptor achieved the most difficult task of a physical hit during the very first trial. The disintegration of the target missile and the dispersion of the debris of the target missile, as seen by the naked eye and on the radar screen, along with deflection of both the missiles, have once again demonstrated the performance of the ballistic missile defense system. Defense Research Development Organization, DRDO, the think tank of India's defense preparedness, is actively involved in the development of a two-layered ballistic missile defense system to intercept and destroy any incoming enemy missile. Defense Research The two-layered ballistic defense system neutralizes targets at exo-atmospheric and endo-atmospheric levels.
This is a very important program, which
while
again
exo-atmospheric
India has taken.
Very important program, and very enthusiastic above 40 kilometers
altitude. Program, the ballistic
the
endo-atmospheric missile defense,
interceptor
which in the world
performs the same
only four
at altitudes below 25 kilometers.
Meaning, enemy's missile when it is coming
the second
towards
demonstration
you,
of
intercepting
interception
in the midair
took place against
is
actual
a very
target missile,
ambitious program. What I can say, in fact.
Missile.
We have done
it was held
about
on 6th
8
December
to 9 launches today.
from the Island
and
Launch
many
Complex,
of them
Odisha.
Have been successful. Many of them have
the
been
target
successful.
Missile, a program simulating which the 600 kilometers class
to intercept at about 20 kilometers altitude and intercepted beyond 100 kilometers altitude.
Why
I'm saying is very ambitious program. There is a video which I think I'm running out of time, so I don't want to show that. But then what I want to say is,
detected the missile,
an interceptor missile
and
passed
the information
is,
to the mission control
when a missile
center
is coming,
through a dedicated, secured communication network.
First thing is, if that missile is traveling with
about 5,000
meters per
second, target missile,
you also will be traveling about 3,000 to 4,000 meters per second. That means the relative velocity between them is anything between
the mission control center assigned the task of interception
is the relative velocity
air defense interceptor.
When you are traveling with that velocity,
after approximately 4 minutes,
the
high velocity
radius
advanced air defense missile rose in pursuit of the distant target.
4, 3, 2, 1,
you need to have an accuracy of 0.2 or 0.3 meters. When you have a relative velocity of 8 meters per second, a timing error of 1 millisecond, you are going to have 8 meters error. So if you have 0.1 millisecond, you are going to have error of 0.8 meters. That means you cannot afford to have an error of timing error of even 0.10 microseconds. So that is the type of accuracy is what you require to do it. But then, as I said, we have been
with a relative velocity,
reasonably
more
good
than
successful ventures we
second.
Had here in this. We have had at least about 6 launches very successful out of this 8 till today. And some more experiments are being done.
Trial.
And as I said, this is a very ambitious program which 4 nations are only pursuing
the debris
here. And
of the
ours is one of the successful programs
the
which is running now.
And, on
and
the
some more experiments
screen,
will be done.
Along
this
with
is a very important program for the nation
once again
today.
Demonstrated the performance
next,
of
I don't want to get into this video. I'll now, the war scenario, when you look at it, it is no more the scenario like earlier. It has become a network-centric warfare today, meaning
Defense Research
today
Development
you have satellites
Organization,
continuously
DRDO,
observing what is what,
the think tank
is what,
of India's defense preparedness,
where is the air force station, where are the troops moving
in the development of
you
a
have AVAX aircraft,
ballistic missile
which are again
defense
monitoring.
System,
you have aerostates which are monitoring today,
any
you have UAVs which
enemy
are monitoring
missile.
Today. Then you have complete network of all these fellows through satellite
system,
communication and whatnot. The data is getting continuously traveled across the country, across everywhere.
Levels.
This is what is a war scenario which the
while
command control centers and whatnot, they transmit, they launch, they missiles.
Above
and many things
kilometers
which happen
altitude,
in the scenario
the
today, this is what the war has become today.
At altitude
war has
below
become very important.
Kilometers.
It has become technology-centric.
The second demonstration
in the sense.
Of interception
so
took place
many technologies are coming into it today,
missile,
and that is what is
ballistic missile.
Gets into that
it
ballistic missile.
It was held on 6th December 2007
all
from the Island Launch
the
Complex, Odisha.
Or any SAM program
the
today.
Missile,
the country has
simulating
to have
the 600 kilometers class of ballistic missile.
Then we also have developed mini guns.
By army personnel
it is one of the guns what has been developed in the country, which is a Dhanush gun,
soon after the launch,
which
the
laboratory in Pune has worked on it, and
a
very good gun which is going
the
into the artillery today.
And passed the information
and
to
then,
the mission control center through a dedicated, secured
we also have developed rockets, which are called Pinaka rockets.
After
long large number of rockets are being produced in the country,
missile,
which again artillery is taking in numbers, and this again developed a laboratory in Pune. Then we also have the MBT Arjun, which is, again, I have to say, this is one of the important things which people will be talking about. The people talk about
the
LCA and Arjun.
After
Arjun, yes,
4 minutes, the
high no doubt it's a fantastic
air defense
tank.
Missile.
There is no doubt about it. Nobody says it's a bad
distant
tank.
Target.
But then what has happened is, when we try to make a specification, we wanted many
now.
Of the best features in that Arjun tank. When you wanted many best, the country, like what happens in Airbus and Boeing or the combined make one aircraft, but still you want to be better than Boeing. So that is not possible. So the weight of the tank has gone up, and so that is where some issues are there, some maintenance issues are there. But then there are more than 100 missiles, 100 tanks have been
and engaged in a
given to armed forces this and a very good
altitude.
Tank and probably with Honorable Raksha Mantri taking a lot of interest
with a relative
here
velocity,
and
more than 2.5
we will be able to get on to this and get large numbers. This is again a laboratory
the
in Pune has developed. You have
the most difficult task of a physical hit
bridges which
the
you can carry on a tank.
The disintegration of the target missile,
of various dimensions, right from 10 meters to about 80 meters, you can lay them
and on the radar,
and on that the tank will travel. This is what you are able to see here. These are all the bridges what have been developed in the laboratory called R&D engineers. Then there are many robotic vehicles, unmanned ground vehicles, which have been developed, which can be used for various purposes. And in fact, some of those fellows are with the
Defense Research Development Organization,
arms
DRDO,
also, and some of the guns also have been incorporated on this, which are very essential today. Some of the parachutes which have been developed indigenously today in the country,
even ballistic missile till
yesterday we didn't have a bulletproof jacket, that also has been developed in the country.
And many things, a
lot of things are happening today in the country which the industry is able to develop now. So these are all the technologies which have developed in the country in a large number, and many technologies have gone, as I said, many of them in the first four or five nations which have gone into it.
Above 40 kilometers altitude,
let me tell you, or let me admit to you, still we are one of the largest importers of defense equipment today.
The second demonstration,
I think, we were there as number one in the world.
Simulating
the
ballistic
Prime Minister
missile.
In the last air show was saying that I don't want to be as a Prime Minister of the country as number one importer of the world.
The target missile,
so luckily after his statement, immediately we came to two. So that's how probably he was happy, probably maybe a little bit. But we are
from the
largest importers.
At Chandipur.
Naturally, Prime Minister will be unhappy to have
it.
So why? There are many things, let me tell you here.
And pass the information to the mission control center.
We have been technology follower.
Secured communication.
We have not been technology leader.
After classification of the target missile,
you don't want to have
import,
you have to be the technology leader.
An altitude of
you cannot be that
kilometers.
Somebody has developed a technology 4 years back, 3 years back, 5 years back,
the task
and you
of
start developing that.
To the advanced
and
air
once he has developed, you have that technology
complex.
After 10 years.
After approximately
you
4 minutes,
have to be contemporary.
High velocity,
meaning within 1 or 2 years
off,
somebody develops, you also need to have.
Target.
When you go to an ordinary colonel or a general, naturally when he wants some equipment, he will also listen to those
equipment
and say that this is what equipment I want. And definitely you don't
executing
have, you will say now you will develop. That means you are going to take another 3 years, 4 years.
The missile,
well, that is already
the
existing. So then he will say that I am 4 years behind, 5 years behind, or 8 years behind. So I want to buy that. You cannot say no to it because he is the man who is going to fight it. So what is required? You
with
need to work on the contemporary
more
technology,
than
contemporary products, meaning you need to work on the advanced technologies or future technologies what are needed and work on those technologies for the country. By the time these advanced nations develop, you are also developing the same time period, then nobody will ask you an import of an equipment. So there is an utter necessity for the country to have one jump from here today where we are, work on the futuristic technologies. That is what is the necessity. I am just mentioning some of those technologies for a while now. Now, when you look at the war, it used to be Army, Air Force,
Defense Net. Research Development
It is no more that. There are fourth
DRDO,
dimension, fifth dimension has already come into it.
Tank of
the
India's
space has become an important element. That is the fourth dimension where the,
in the
anybody look at it, you must have heard the Iraq war when we said there is going to be war. People have launched a couple of satellites.
Know
the entire spread of what is what. Start attacking them.
Two-layered ballistic defense system.
Neutralize them. Make them dummy. Then send the armed forces.
And endo-atmospheric
man
levels.
On the ground. That is what is the space.
While
so
an
you need to have a space technology
specifically
for the armed forces today. For
above
the defense.
40 kilometers
next,
altitude,
very important element is the cyber.
Interceptor
cyber has also has become a cyber warfare. This is world now today, cyber warfare. Is
the second
the
demonstration of interception.
You also need to have cyber deterrences and cyber defense play in the country. Very important. It is not just a police officer's job. It is for the internet.
Complex,
it is everybody's job today in the country.
The target missile,
economy,
simulating the 600
power will be
kilometers
shut down.
Class of ballistic
the complete
missile
powers can be shut down by the cyber
by
warfare
Army personnel
so
from the launch complex.
A lot of work needs to be done. Particularly, I'm telling you, youngsters have to do. It is very difficult the way you operate the computers or whatnot and all that. I will not be able to operate the speed of it even one-tenth of it. So youngsters who have to do. This is what Israel has done. Somebody can get into it called unit meet 80 to 100.
There's a model which they have created.
Only youngsters. The number of units have started, unit 80 to 100, only youngsters. They all develop cyber products,
various things, use them.
This is what is the necessity which I am sure I think country also will be able to do a lot. So in the cyber security, when you look at it, today what is the necessity of the country, I want to tell you. You are continuously, we are all talking about cell phones. The entire infrastructure today is outsourced. You don't have your router, you don't have your software, you don't have your instrument. Everything is bought out.
Very high
Where is the security?
And sharp turns.
So you need to have interceptor right from missile, devices.
Guided by the radio frequency seeker.
You need to have your own server. You need to have your own router.
Target missile.
You need to have your own operating
system. And engaged in a direct hit.
Then
at
only
15
you can have
kilometers
a
altitude.
There is a necessity to develop all these things within the country, and which country
with
needs
the relative
to use
velocity
it in the infrastructure
more than 2.5
I cannot have complete Chinese equipment and say that I am secure today. It is impossible.
The interceptor,
so you need to have all those things in the country. That is one important thing what I have mentioned here.
During the very first trial.
Then the same thing connected to that, many of those cyber-related things.
Then space. The target missile,
lot of technologies for the space we need to develop.
And on
space,
the radars,
what I have talked in the beginning is about the civilian space.
The
when we talk here,
once again
I need to have electronic intelligence, I need to have communication intelligence, I need to have a formation frame, I need to have a launch on demand, I need to have a hyperspectral payload, I need to have an infrared imaging system. So these are all the systems what needs to be put in the payload as in the satellites, and then defense should be able
defense
to launch on its satellites.
Development
that is another important area
DRDO,
where we need to work.
The think tank
then terahertz
of
technology. In fact, this technology is more applicable to the MHA people or the paramilitary forces.
Ballistic missile
you are attacking some terrorists, you are attacking some Naxalites related
any
or any other people,
missile.
And they are in the forest. Today you don't have any means of knowing it at all.
Ballistic
this is the technology which makes you transparent and see all those people and get it and all that. This is one area where people need to work
levels.
A lot in these new technologies.
While an exo-atmospheric interceptor interrupts and destroys
MEMS
a missile,
MEMS is another area where you need to work a lot. MEMS, nanotechnology, this is one area where a lot of market is going to be there worldwide.
Kilometers. The second demonstration of interception took
then
place.
Then another important area is the magnetic
magnets.
Magnetic area is one important thing, which again today, in fact, yesterday somebody was asking
launch
also.
Complex,
we are importing most of the magnets.
The target
today.
Missile, simulating
we are
the
600 most of the
kilometers
today.
Class of
this is one important area actually.
Was prepared and
I
launched by army personnel.
I think are
from
missing
the launch
here.
Complex.
One important
Chandigarh.
Area where we need to work in the country is the materials.
The radars,
materials
located at Konark and
base. Basic area where country needs to work for any of these technologies
the
what I have talked
center
about.
Through a dedicated,
we cannot be dependent on materials from various
network.
Countries and get them here and then you cannot
after
say that I am self-reliant. So you need to make many magnets, many rare earth materials, many other alloys we need to develop. That is one important area where we are. And magnetic levitation is going to be one of the important areas even for missile launches, rocket launches, particularly from ships and all that. You can with the magnetic force, you will be able to pump in these rockets into the space and all that areas is one technology what people will be working. Then this is another area, important area is SMS, shaped memory alloys. This is one thing for the non-engineers I want to say. This is one a material which can remember its shape. When you create that condition, it goes back to its shape. So tremendous applications in this. If you are able to develop these alloys for many things, whichever way you want to use it, you can use it. You want to change aperture of it, you want to push at given time for anything into given position, whatnot. This is one area which has a tremendous application. Then, these are going to be the materials, as I said, many of those things, SMAs, ceramics, and antennas which are skin-mounted antennas or skin antennas and many other technologies with smart materials is one thing UAVs we need to develop. The four rotors, the quadrupolar technologies and all that are very routine today. We are able to see in the marriages also many people coming with the UAV and then camera shooting and all that, they have become very common. Not that. See, the colleges should not work on the very, very normal things where you are also having this type of a technology. What we need to work on is on this type of a technologies with even smart wings, whatnot, all those things. These are the important things what we need to work on technologies. This is one important area, what I have talked about earlier also, ISRO. We need to develop a hypersonic missile, which both Russia and China have developed. You need to have a hypersonic engine, scramjet engine, which we need to develop. I don't want to get into it much. Then the cyborgs is another important area which, again, youngsters have to take up. This is one thing where you are able to use the cognitive technologies. You are able to get into any area. You are able to get into the communication. You are able to get the video. And you are able to communicate. And you are able to, sitting at far off, you are able to make it go anywhere, wherever you want, without affecting anything physically to that fly. You're not damaging or you're not killing it or not doing it. You're only controlling it and sending it is an important area. Today, like a terrorist there in a house, you will be able to simply know from this. Smart dust is another technology area. Dust is... Then you have a MEMS and NEMS technology and RF MEMS technology and all that. And then the smart dust is another area which will be able to get onto it, this. Smart soldier is another important area. This is going to be a reality tomorrow. He has everything with him. Even sensing, many sensing, automatic injections, automatic medicine being given, automatic communication. He has a wraparound display. He knows what is happening, what is there ahead. Communication continuously, every soldier, where he is, everything will be known. This is another important area which people need to work. So there are many other technologies, like you have self-healing materials, biosensors and whatnot and all that, morphing control technologies, which are very important. All these technologies are the technologies which we need to start working today by the time somebody realizes. And I have mentioned only very symbolic technologies today. There are many technological areas which we need to work on, all these technologies, engines and rockets and even anti-UAV technologies, or laser-based weapons, high-energy laser-based weapons and all that. Now, having done all these things, to do it, to make this a reality, what is important is these three elements, what I have said, to work together. Academia, the R&D organizations, and the industry. If these three don't work together continuously, it's very, very difficult. What I'm trying to say here, this is one slide which is very important, what I say. The academic institutes should concentrate more on the basic research. If academic institutes don't concentrate on the basic research, who else can concentrate? Who will do? You need to get the basic background out of it and give it, maybe doing some applied research. Then the R&D organizations should take more applied research and development as their background. Then the public sector should be able to concentrate on development and production. The private sector, let me be very specific here, they also need production, they need to sustain, they need to have their turnaround and turnovers and all that, but they need to do a R&D in the niche areas. It is not new. Today in ICT area, most of the innovations which have come are from the private industry. So private industries need to work in some of the R&D areas and they should come out with the technologies. We are ready. In fact, even day before yesterday, Honorable Raksha Mantri was telling. Raksha Mantri, being an IIT student, being a materials man, and he understands everything and he has a tremendous memory. One of the few people whom I have seen in my life, probably a man who has got tremendous memory. What he sees today, what many of us may be having a good memory to remember the names of a person. He remembers numbers also. That is the important thing. So we are always very on our toes to... When we write a statement or a file, we are very careful when we are sending it to present Raksha Mantri. He has been saying many of these areas we have to offload to the industry, let industry work, and DRDO type of R&D organization should concentrate on the core research and the innovative research or applied to translational research should be done by the industry. So this is what we are thinking. But one important thing what I want to tell you here is about the academic institutes. What I want to say is today you find a lot of people criticizing maybe DRDO or atomic energy till maybe about 5 years back, ISRO, whenever there was a failure in the launch and all that, you have been, many people have been criticizing thing. I'm not trying to criticize anyone. What I'm trying to say is, we need to have academic institutes which are getting into the deep-rooted research. Without that type of a deep-rooted research and fundamentals getting into it and students coming out of that type of a institutes or background research being done, no country can develop any advanced technologies. And in fact, what I want to say is, I've said ISRO, or I've talked about atomic energy, I've talked about DRDO in many of these areas where you were among the first or second or third or fourth or fifth or seventh nation in the country, or maybe first 10 in the world, you have been standing. But you don't have a single academic institute in the country which is standing in the first 100. Without one academic institute standing in the first 100, how do you expect, and most of the IIT students are going abroad and left out with the people, and how do you expect them to do in the first 5? So this is an important topic where the academic institutes need to do a lot. They need to get into the deep-rooted research. Just don't do, wherever you go to an academic institute, you will be showing a UAV flying with a quadrotor, or there is a very small tie is made following a track and all that. You need to do much better thing where I have to learn from you. I have to learn from the academic institutes. That is what is the most important today to the country if we need to develop the technologies of tomorrow. So there are many steps which have been taken because many industries are there. One, just two slides. There is a technology fund created which industry can be funded now. This is one mechanism what has been brought now. There is also innovation research funding. This also is a mechanism which government has created, which anybody comes out with an innovative idea, he can be funded now. The file is, I think, almost through or getting approved now, almost at the stage. Then in the DPP, what has been announced recently, the utmost important is given to the IDDM, Indian Design Developed and Manufactured Item, is the topmost priority what you can see. That is the topmost priority which has been given in the DPP today for the Indian Design Developed Models. So that is what trying to make the Make in India or the startup in the world, country today. Only thing is, we have to be cautious. I keep telling the government also in the Make in India, what I have today, we don't want them to come and make here in India and make this industry fail here. What we don't have, only those people should be coming. So the order of priority of those things should be brought in that way that we'll be able to make the industries who are already working here survive and then flourish. And then what I don't have technology, what I don't have infrastructure only, those people should come here and establish the industries and make country know about it. This is what Make in India in that concept. And also, as I said, if the people who are going out of the colleges, who are gone to abroad, unless they come and establish here, there are no doubts, there are still a lot many hurdles. Even the government is trying to remove many hurdles. There are a lot of hurdles. If it is very, very simple, why everybody has to come here? They can work anywhere also. Yes, it is not easy, but still people still have to come and work in the difficult area only. If everything is fine, the people here itself can manage everything and they can do it. So people have to come, work in the harsh environment and hard environment, and things are becoming simpler today. The government is making many, many, many things simpler today. Work and make the technologies and develop the technologies and make the country flourish. And I also want to say that industries cannot survive with the domestic market alone. They have to export. They have to earn foreign exchange to the country. Then only the country will flourish. If you supply here, I only may be able to save that whatever profit that fellow is taking. But if I want to earn a lot to the country, you need to make an item to the domestic people and also export a lot and gain a lot of foreign exchange. That is where you also need to do in research. You need to produce a quality item with a sustained quality. That is where all of us, industry, academia, R&D institutes, public sector, and everybody has to work, then only the country will flourish. That is what we are going to do. I am sure that all of you, particularly seeing the people in Belgavi, next 10 years, I think all our imports will be brought down to less than about 20-25%, and exports today what we have will go up by 400%. That is what I am thinking, that is what I imagine, that is what I want all of you to work towards that. Thank you very much for giving this opportunity.
Thank you, sir. We'll have a very quick two, three questions which Sateesh Reddy will answer. I request to be delegates to be very specific and focused on the questions. Please, sir.
Sorry, I have exceeded my time and then eaten away into your questions. But during lunch, we can have our questions, yeah. Whoever is not able to ask.
My name is Sharad Pai. I'm an industrialist. Many times we see the day we test the missiles in India, within 3 days or fourth day, the neighbor test fires. And the country which has not having given the technology to produce a car, are they having such kind of a technology to do that, or it is kind of a funded, or it is like kind of a psychological war?
I think you have almost given the answer in your question itself. Many are coming from outside. I don't want to get into further details, but many coming from outside, majorly.
Hello, I'm Professor A.B. Kulkarni, I'm from physics. So I have 2 points in brief. Most of the vehicle engines brought from outside, so this is what I heard, and it is nearly about 90%. So is it true? That is the first one. And second one, can you elaborate on nuclear power plant, that Indian power plant are in phase one, going to phase two, whereas other countries are in phase four. To make up that gap, India made collaboration for phase five with many of the countries which uses thorium product. So is this collaboration happen in real?
First question, yes, engines, we haven't done many of the engines in the country. Most of those engines have been imported technology or technology transfers which have been developed even in the most of the automobile sector, except one or two what they have developed on their own. That is the scenario is same for even aircrafts also. But then we have developed one engine which will be getting into this, as I said, Nirbhay and other engines will be able to get into that engine, and that's the scenario about the air engines also. Nuclear power, I don't want to answer you from here so many things, but then efforts are on to kill the gap, and capability exists, and the resources will be managed.
Sir, one... Myself, Mantesh Marikatti from SDM Engineering College, Professor. Sir, as you told, nuclear energy is highly used, but nuclear energy, on the same aspect, it is having hazardous effects on the people, and most of the people are affected by the hazardous rays, nuclear fission and fusion. Just I want to stress, can the non-conventional energy sources like solar energy, wind energy, can they be used? Can the solar energy, wind energy, they can be used heavily as they are available freely in spite of nuclear energy? Because nuclear energy sources, they are having heavier impact, side effects by their nuclear chain reactions.
What is your subject?
Mine is energy management.
So you also have physics as your subject?
No, sir. Basically, I'm from mechanical engineering department.
So a little bit know about a reactor and reactor, how, what are the safety measures being taken and all that.
Yes, sir.
I want to ask you one straight question. You have so many reactors in the country today.
Yes, sir.
There are thousands of employees working in those reactors. Show me one employee who is working there, not fellows who are staying away 2 kilometers, 3 kilometers away, who has been affected by the so-called effects what you have said, and who are not well or who have died out of it. One fellow. Just don't go by, particularly people like you who are learned people, don't go by just thing. They are the normal nuclear effects if you have used a nuclear fusion activity openly against someone. These are all controlled activities which are being done. There are thousands of people in India itself who are working in these reactors for tens of years without even minute effect on them till today. You have not seen, you go to Bark or you go to Kalpakkam or you go to Tarapur or wherever it is, nothing is there. Number two, your wind energy and other things are to be encouraged. There are no doubts in that, or alternative energies to be encouraged. There are no doubts about it. But finally, when you look at the total country's need, this cannot be even 5%, even if you go in our full magnitude, or it may, if you think very overwhelmingly, it cannot cross even 10% because of their own limitations, what they are there today. So that is why you need to have this energy also. You need to have that, you need to have this. Now all possible sources, you need to comply and try to do it. But only thing is, what I am to say is, don't have unnecessary apprehensions on the areas and then try to create an apprehension in the people who are not educated also. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
You tell me, I will repeat the question.
This kind of indigenous defense products are made here or somewhere else. Sir, don't you think that hum log kisi ko pistol mein goli dal ke de rahe ki maro hame? Don't you think, sir, hum log jab bechte hai, when we sell to other countries, these are which we make indigenously, don't you think there is a threat from others?
One thing is, when you make it, you are not going to sell it to Pakistan, definitely. Okay? You are going to sell it, there is a Ministry of External Affairs. Who knows that in a long term, which are countries with whom we will not have conflict, in a long term. We will be selling only to those countries and ensuring that that country doesn't sell it to your friends. Okay, this is what is always ensured. But if you think that you will never be able to sell it, but then you have to ensure who is your friend and foe and that, all those things, and you will be doing it.
Yeah. Hello.
Please.
Yes, sir. This is a general question regarding education.
Now, in your last slide, you mentioned about the education and research. I am Suresh Jangam Shetty from Basaveshwara Engineering College, Bagalkot. We are in a hurry to attain, either regain our power as a, one of the country. We had all the resources earlier, we have invented and all that. But when you look at the current education, even at the primary section, from where the roots begin for the research. So not much weightage for the research at bent of mind to the children is not being put. So what is the government thinking in this regard? Primary education is must, where students will start thinking. Otherwise, most of the inputs which come to most of the colleges, they are not having that much of bent of research.
Question,
so this is required.
I'll answer you. First thing is, what is government doing? I will answer from MOD. We are thinking of trying to establish many institutes in this area where the institutes will be able to doing research. This is number one. Number two, we have also given number of projects to various academic institutes. We are working with about 120 academic institutes where we are given the research projects we are giving. Third, today, you have a number of private universities. The government is not alone deciding your syllabus. You yourself are deciding. Who stops you doing from research? Why you have to be dependent on government? You please have research topics in your own side, and then you produce students who have it. We will take them. So please do it. I keep actually telling the private universities, private engineering colleges, why don't you get some two professors from US or UK who are Indians? You pay them actually per month 10 lakh rupees also. In fact, I'll tell you, I went to my hometown, Nellore. The doctors there in the hospitals are paid 13 lakhs per month. That means he has got a business. So if you can get 13 lakhs, you pay a professor who is an extraordinary man from Carling Midland University or somewhere else and all that, he is an Indian. You get him here, you get a lab. You can ask also your donation for 2.5 lakhs per month also for a year also, and people will be still joining. India doesn't have any problem in joining. You will get a good business also. But nobody is attempting that. Go in a routine manner, a normal thing and all that, and trying to do it and all that. So please look in differently, make and get good professors, get academic institutes. Any academic institute is good only if the professors are good. Remaining things are all left. Second.
Sir.
Please.
One of the reasons cited by the government to cancel Setu Samudram project is that the large resources of thorium, which would act as the fuel for fast breeder reactors in Tamil Nadu. How far this is true? Whether this is the actual reason why the Setu Samudram project is cancelled?
I am not from the department, so I will not be able to answer that question. I don't know.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Dr. Sanjay Deshpande. I have a question, sir, that you have shown in the armed force, in defense, what you have shown in तो अपने पास उतना कैपेसिटी है कि हम पाकिस्तान को काउंटरपार्ट कर सके? सिंपल क्वेश्चन.
I don't want to answer this question being a government official, but I think idhar ka hai raksha mantri aate rehte hain yahan pe aas paas mein hai goa mein hai kabhi bahut bar papers mein statement hi kiya hai hamare paas dam hai dekhne ke liye logon ko. I am only repeating what my raksha mantri has said. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Lot of interesting question arises. Due to paucity of time, we couldn't make it. In lunch break, we can definitely have an open session with Sateesh Reddy, sir. I'm so glad to have Sateesh Reddy, sir, for his talk, and delighted to have, and thanks for taking us to the exciting side of innovation and development that's happening on our defense sector. Thank you very much, sir. I would like to request Sri Havnurji, the president of this function, to felicitate Dr. Sateesh Reddy, sir, with a moment. Thank you very much, sir.